Really interesting hearing from the general yesterday, talking about some of the formalities, but also hearing that personal, those personal stories as well. Let's pick up on that theme now. We'll speak to someone who's known the Duke of Edinburgh pretty much all his life. It's Robert Woods, who's joining us from Pembrokeshire. Very good morning to you, Robert. I'm very pleased that we can speak to you this morning, because you and your family have a unique connection to the Duke of Edinburgh. To goes back to what, when you were 15 years old.
That's correct. When my father was appointed the Dean of Windsor in the early 60s, you're right, I was 15 then. And we got to know Philip. Go on.
No, please carry on. Just tell us a little bit more about that connection.
Well, the connection was when we lived at Windsor, as you say, I was 15-year-old, we got to know Prince Charles, Princess Anne pretty well. But the real thing that sticks in my mind is my father's own relationship with, obviously, the Queen, but with Prince Philip, and the formation of St George's House, which is a sort of paramount thing that makes me think of that period.
Tell us, a lot of people listening to you now will not know what that is. So explain what that is, and what the intention of that organisation was.
Well, what happened was, when my father was appointed the Dean in early 60s, he felt that much more could be done with the foundation of St George's. Coincidentally with that, they were having a big reorganization of the accommodation there. And my father thought that they should have turned it into a center for consultation for people to think about wider and global issues. And he put this plan to Prince Philip, who was a great enthusiast for doing it. The Netflix film on St George's House did actually slightly show Prince Philip showing not that much enthusiasm. This was not correct. He was very enthusiastic about setting up a consultation centre in St George's, where people, the great and the good, could talk about, as I say, wider issues of ethics, interfaith, and also the role of the clergy. And that's why I think it's very important today to think about St George's House, because that reflects on a side of Prince Philip that I feel probably has not had enough publicity in the last few days. He was very interested in the spiritual and religious aspects, and this came through in his chairmanship of St George's House very clearly.
Robert, I mean, for a lot of people, they will have seen some of that relationship, your father's relationship, and what happened there via television, via The Crown, which must have been strange for you as a family, knowing it firsthand as you did.
It was. The Crown programme was interesting. It wasn't particularly correct, if I may say so. What it didn't get through clearly enough until the very end, and those who watched The Crown will have noticed there was a footnote at the end of the programme which said how important St George's House was to the Duke and all his thinking about spiritual and religious and ethical matters. And I think that was a great value of the Crown programme. And if I could go on from that, relating to the Duke today, a follow on from St George's House, which was extremely important and still is and is ably run, two comments I'd like to make. One is, a council ran it, which Prince Philip chaired, and I was on that council. And he was an extremely efficient and precise chairman. And I will never forget the way he handled meetings, and indeed the way he put people right who weren't quite correct in what they said. But following on from St George's, in my father's letters, there are many letters from Prince Philip to my father debating spiritual, religious, ethical issues. And indeed, one of the last letters he wrote, which I have, was about a talk he was going to give on business ethics, and something that really concerned him. And so that shows a side of Prince Philip that really cared about these wider issues that I feel we need to put across clearly today.
Robert, can I bring you back to events today, 3 p.m. this afternoon, the funeral itself. And I know you are still close friends with Prince Charles and Princess Anne. Many people making the point that so many people's thoughts will be with Her Majesty the Queen and the Duke of Edinburgh's immediate family for what is an event that the world will see, but in its very essence is a family funeral, a family grieving a loved one.
Absolutely, and that's what it is. And it's in its rightful place in the Choir of St. George's, which is a very small and private place. It's not a huge, great nave with 800 people. And I think that's the importance of today. It is a family occasion.
And many people, Robert, and you know this place well, have reflected on, because of the necessity of COVID restrictions, the numbers so limited, just 30 people actually attending within the chapel itself, it will possibly have a much more personal feel that might otherwise have been the case.
Oh, very much so, and I think that's probably rather a good thing. Rather than having the choir can hold many, many more people than 30 people, and I think cutting it down to 30 will give it that personal flavour which you mentioned. I think that's probably a good thing.
Robert, thank you so much for joining us today, and I'm sure you, like millions of people here in the UK and around the world, will be watching events as they unfold on television. So thank you so much for speaking to us this morning.
And thank you for your time, and I hope all goes well with the funeral. Thank you.
Well, yes, absolutely. We have a spectacular setting today. You'll have seen behind me this morning the blue skies and the bright sunshine over Windsor Castle. You can see we're just in the grounds, actually, of the castle itself. But of course, the events themselves, the procession, the very personal elements will take place within the walls of the castle itself. The weather could not be more fitting to what will be a remarkable occasion. So we'll leave you with those images, and I will hand you back to the studio and to Naga.
Charlie, thanks very much. You saw that sunshine there over St. George's Chapel in Windsor, and it's pretty much the picture that's going to be painted across the UK this morning. But a cold start, Louise. Morning.
Yes, good morning, Naga. It is a cold start. Temperatures fell below freezing, down as low as -5 in some spots. But you can see there is a lot of blue sky and sunshine to go with that. And the satellite picture is just coming in now. You can see how extensive that sunshine is. Yes, there is some thicker cloud further north and west. And this is rain-bearing cloud out in the Atlantic, an indication of what's to come. But it's going to take its time in arriving. So for most of us, it is a quiet story with that high pressure still keeping things fine and dry. A little bit of fair weather cloud developing across England and Wales through the heat of the day, but temperatures should peak generally between 11 and 14 degrees. We might see 15 in one or two spots as well. That rain, well, that arrives through the night tonight into Northern Ireland and to Western Scotland. Bit more of a breeze. The ice bars squeezing together as those fronts move in. That's actually going to prevent those temperatures from falling below freezing here at around 6 to 8 degrees. But under clearer skies, we could see temperatures into low single figures. A light frost still not out of the question. But there will be more sunshine to come for the second half of the weekend. Some light patchy rain moving through Scotland and Northern Ireland, clouding over across the borders into Wales and southwest England. So it looks likely that to the east of the Pennines is where we'll see the best of the sunshine tomorrow afternoon, with highs of 15 degrees. Now, as we move out of Sunday into Monday, that weather front hasn't really moved very far at all. We might continue to see more in the way of cloud, particularly the further west you are associated with that front. So the best of the drier, sunnier moments likely to be into sheltered eastern areas, but we could still see a pleasant feel. That's temperatures back to where they should be really for this time of year, 11 to 16 degrees the high. High pressure is going to move in from the Atlantic through the middle part of the week, and with winds swinging in a clockwise direction, that means a return to a northerly component. That's going to drive in colder air once again across the country. Not for all. You can see how we keep the yellow tones across really south of the M4 corridor. So that means through the middle part of the week, there is the potential for a slight drop in the temperature, but then they hopefully bounce back as we move towards next weekend, largely fine and dry. So I say it's a quiet story. Yes, it's chilly out there at the moment, but there's a good deal of dry weather and a good deal of sunshine to look out for. Naga.
Louise, thanks very much. It's just coming up to 9:15. We should find out what's happening in the world of sport. You know, John, morning.
Okay.
I was talking to Walker in Scotland, able to get out now. Very excited. We saw Dan's report earlier in Leeds, where people in England now able to drink at pubs outside, of course. But sport's taken it a step further, inside.
Yes, trying to follow suit a little bit. And snooker today with the return of the World Championship in Sheffield, one of those events being used to really test the safe return of spectators to sport. And I think, you know, a lot of other events will have a close eye on how things play out over the coming days. But worth pointing out as well, it's not just snooker, a number of other kind of sporting events being used as well to do much the same. Yes, good morning. A lot of focus, as I was saying, on the Crucible Theatre in Sheffield as spectators are welcomed back for the World Championship. And fair to say, the success of this pilot will determine the speed at which other indoor events can begin to open up. Laura Scott is outside the Crucible for us this morning. Good morning, Laura. A huge day for snooker, as we've been saying there, and for live sport in general. But I guess worth pointing out, it's quite a big logistical operation, isn't it? Because all of those fans who are going to be in attendance have to pass a COVID test. So I imagine it's taken some organising for the tournament organisers there today.
Yes, John, the first few fans are just starting to gather in Tudor Square outside the Crucible, and then have had to have filled out a whole checklist of things if they're going to get inside the Crucible this morning to watch Ronnie O'Sullivan begin his World Championship title defence. Now, first and foremost on that checklist is they'll have had to have passed a negative lateral flow COVID test. That can't be one of the ones that you do at home. It has to have been done at an official testing centre, because they'll have to provide photographic evidence of that negative COVID test and some photo ID to go with it. They'll have also had to sign a consent form to agree to be part of the government's events research programme, of which today's pilot is the first event. It's also been requested that ticket holders take a PCR test before and after the events as part of the programme. That's to help gather data on any impact on transmission of COVID in the local community and where ticket holders live. So yes, there is a huge logistical operation going into today's event. There's a compound behind me where the queues will move through to get inside the venue. But remember, this is about trying to get large crowds back at live events this summer. And actually, although there are only 300 people here today, that's around a third capacity. By the finals and 2 weekends' time, the hope is that the Crucible will be at full capacity. Now, that will be the first time an event in the UK has been held in front of a full house since before COVID.
And of course, as you were saying, that big logistical operation is only going to ramp up, isn't it, as they admit more spectators over the coming days. We were saying that other sports, other events will be watching. How will this pilot be deemed a success?
Well, the government has said that the whole events research programme is science-led, so it will all be about the data that is gathered from all of the pilots. They've been selected to test small and large venues, indoors and outdoors. I mean, today's setting is taking place in a theatre, so yes, it will be testing the safety of an indoor sports crowd, but it will also help inform, you know, audiences in the West End. And I spoke to the World Snooker Tour chairman Barry Hearn earlier in the week. He said he'd had Andrew Lloyd Webber on the phone saying, please help me get fans back in my theatres. And so yes, this is very much not just about sport. This is about the whole live event industry. Tomorrow's FA Cup semi-final at Wembley between Leicester and Southampton is due to have 4,000 fans, and that's as much about outdoor sports crowds as it is outdoor music concert crowds. You know, this is very much across industry, and it will have a pivotal bearing on what this summer looks like in terms of live events.
Okay, Laura Scott, live for us in Sheffield outside the Crucible Theatre. Many thanks indeed for that. And as Laura was saying there, one of the other pilots, we'll see football taking part in that as well. We'll see fans return around 4,000 at Wembley tomorrow. That's for the FA Cup semi-final between Southampton against Leicester. Before that, though, Manchester City are up against Chelsea at an empty Wembley later on today. Football Focus on air at midday on BBC Two. Dan Walker joins us. Good morning, Dan.
Morning, John.
As Laura was saying, 4,000 fans expected at Wembley for that second semi-final tomorrow. I guess on the programme today, you'll be ramping up to those two big games to come.
Yes, John. Good morning to you. Morning, everybody. Yeah, we'll be live at Wembley today, having a look at today's semi-final, as you said, Chelsea against Manchester City, and also looking ahead to Leicester against Southampton. And a reflection of all that's happening today. We know Charlie's down at Windsor this morning. We're actually on BBC Two today. Normal time from midday until 1 o'clock, as the BBC One will be dedicated to the build-up to the Duke of Edinburgh's funeral. And we'll look at those FA Cup semi-finals, as you say. We've got Thomas Tuchel, the Chelsea manager, who's had a brilliant 3 months in charge at the club, taking over from Frank Lampard. We've got an interview with him. And in terms of Manchester City, we've got a lovely interview with a guy called Mark McCarthy, who's the cousin of Mick McCarthy, who football fans will know very well. And he's a collector of Manchester City match-worn shirts, so shirts that have actually been used in a game. He's got over 350 of them. The oldest one is actually from the 1926 Cup Final. He's got one from the Bert Trautmann Final of 1956. He's got all sorts of shirts, including the rarest one he's got is a shirt they wore in 1989, a yellow one against Arsenal. And it's so rare because the chairman was so disappointed by their 4-0 defeat in that game, he said, we're never going to wear that shirt again. So only 16 of them were ever made. And he's got one. He says he's looking forward to his daughter leaving for university so he can use her bedroom to continue to store some of his shirt collection. We've got the goals from last night, Everton against Spurs. Got a lovely piece as well with Calvin Phillips of Leeds, playing really well this season, playing for England as well. Born in Leeds, brought up in Leeds, a big influence from his mum and his grandma to stay at the club and make sure he could continue his career there. And he spent a day with Ian Wright, former Arsenal and England striker, talking about where he grew up. And here's a little snippet even of that interview of them spending a day together in Leeds.
Well, this is still called the Mushy Field, we call it.
What is this? What did you used to play here?
Yeah, these new houses up here, this was like a mushroom farm.
Right.
So years ago when I was little, we used to come up here, we used to call it the Mushy, all our friends used to call it the Mushy, and this is where we used to play.
Did you play for hours?
Hours on end. And even when I signed my contract at Leeds, you know, my friends were going out and kicking up.
You go and play with them,
yeah,
still?
Yeah.
But it's the same thing when I was at Palace. I was at Palace in the first team, and I'd still go to the park and play. It's like you can't stop yourself.
It's
ridiculous. Can you imagine if you got injured?
That's what I mean, yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Plenty more of that on the programme. Understanding of Ian Wright and many other players of that generation used to play football, but tell people, make sure you don't tackle us because we're playing at the weekend as well. We've got a piece on Northern Ireland's women who's qualified for their first ever major tournament. That's the Euros 2022. And all the kickoffs today in the Championship have been moved from 3 o'clock to 12:30. One of those is Brentford, who take on Millwall. Got a nice piece on them. Mark Clement's been to see their boss, Thomas Franks. And just to return, John, to those FA Cup semi-finals. We're speaking to a Leicester fan who was at two of the three FA Cup finals that Leicester played in the 1960s. Actually, lost all three of them, but somebody who was at two of them. And from a Southampton point of view, will relive maybe their most famous Wembley moment, 1976, when Second Division Southampton, under Laurie McMenemy, beat Manchester United in the final. So Laurie McMenemy is taking a look back at that famous final for us. So we're on from midday on BBC Two, and we'll be with Dion Dublin and Jermaine Beckford for Football Focus. See you then.
Thanks, Dan. Some great memories there. Many thanks indeed for that. As Dan was saying, midday today, Football Focus, obviously the snooker follows. And it was interesting, obviously, hearing from Laura, just the logistical operation that's going on at the Crucible at the moment to try and obviously make sure everybody's passed those COVID tests to get in. They've obviously got to put on the event itself. And interesting that, you know, Barry Hearn's been speaking to Andrew Lloyd Webber, because other events are going to be taking notice, aren't they, about how successfully this goes.
It will make a massive difference as well to the atmosphere for those participants.
Absolutely, hugely.
John, thanks very much. Time now is 7 minutes to nine. Now, from James Bond to Harry Potter, Peaky Blinders and Doctor Who, the actor Helen McCrory lit up some of the biggest films and television series of the last 20 years, as well as having a highly acclaimed stage career. Yesterday, she died at the age of just 52. Let's take a look at some of her work.
Funny, I'm actually rather nervous.
Why? You met her often enough before.
I know, but never one-to-one. And never as Prime Minister.
Well, just remember, you're a man that's just been elected by the whole nation.
It's as if you insist on pretending we still live in a golden age of espionage.
Summer as big as the sky. Through some, we saw worlds and people. And through others, we saw silence. And the end of all things.
Is he alive?
Are you armed?
No.
Then I'll tell you.
Helen McCrory, who died yesterday at the age of 52. Well, we can hear more about her amazing talent from our entertainment correspondent, Colin Patterson. Colin, morning to very sad news that we heard yesterday of Helen's passing.
and such a shock. I think so few people knew that she was ill. She'd been on TV doing interviews, publicising the Edinburgh Trust within the last month and a half. So a real shock at 4:30 yesterday when Damian Lewis, her husband, the Homeland star, put this tweet out just saying that he was heartbroken to announce that after a heroic battle with cancer, the beautiful and mighty woman that is Helen McCrory had died peacefully at home, surrounded by a wave of love from her friends and family, adding that she died as she lived, fearlessly. Now, Damian Lewis and Helen McCrory had met when they did a play together. It was called Five Gold Rings. And the director, Michael Attenborough, has said they had such amazing chemistry on stage that it was like trying to direct a fire. And Helen McCrory's often spoken about her marriage. And she said she had a trick that when she was at a party and she couldn't find Damian Lewis, she'd go up to the DJ, get him to put on Grace Jones, pull up to the bumper, and he would always find her because that was their song. Mm. And apparently they did a lot of dancing at home together.
Yeah, it was a very, very moving tribute from Damian Lewis. I mentioned just a few of the films and television programmes she appeared in. Many will remember her as Polly in Peaky Blinders, but she had such a varied career, didn't she?
Yeah, Polly in Peaky Blinders, the treasurer and matriarch of the Shelby family. What a role that was. She was in all five series of that. But as you say, such a diverse career. In the 1990s, she made her name on the stage in London. She came straight out of drama school and onto the National Theatre stage. She did The Seagull there, got another five roles shortly afterwards, which really established her. Then in the 2000s, she diversified into films. Many people will remember her playing Sherry Blair opposite Michael Sheen's Tony Blair in The Queen. Helen Mirren would go on to win an Oscar for that. And it was a role she'd reprise on TV in The Special Relationship. Then there was Harry Potter. Now, she was originally cast in that series as Bellatrix Lestrange, but she fell pregnant at that time, had to withdraw, and that role went to Helena Bonham Carter. But then she finally got her moment. She was given the role of Narcissa Malfoy, one of the baddies in that series. And I think one of the reasons, again, why it was such a shock yesterday's news was the fact she had two huge hits last year during lockdown. There was Roadkill, the BBC One political drama with Hugh Laurie. And then earlier in the year, one of the best shows of the year, Quiz, an ITV drama which reunited her with Michael Sheen. It was about the coughing major, the Who Wants to Be a Millionaire scandal, and she played the barrister of the Ingrams. And when she arrived in that series, it was the energy and ferocity that she brought to those courtroom scenes. One of the crucial parts of making that show a hit that was seen by almost 10 million people a night during lockdown. I mean, when you think of the film, she worked with Martin Scorsese on Hugo, and she did Bond. She was in Skyfall as an MP, and that meant she completed the Holy British Trilogy. She'd done Doctor Who, she'd done Harry Potter, and she'd done James Bond. Let's see a clip of her in Skyfall.
It's as if you insist on pretending we still live in a golden age of espionage, where human intelligence was the only resource available. Well, I find this rather old-fashioned belief demonstrates a reckless disregard.
Minister, I don't mean to interrupt, but just for the sake of variety, might we actually hear from the witness?
Of course.
Now, we saw Helen McCrory there in Skyfall, and she had such a large breadth of career and different roles, and undoubtedly made many, many friends in the industry.
And they've been paying tribute to her overnight. And in the last few hours, Cillian Murphy, the star of Peaky Blinders, has put out a tribute saying he's brokenhearted to lose such a dear friend, describing her as a beautiful, caring, funny, compassionate human being and also a gifted actor, fearless, magnificent. That word fearless is coming up a lot today, elevating and making humane every scene, every character she played. We are wondering if she had done any filming for the final series of Peaky Blinders, Series 6. Benjamin Zephaniah, who is appearing in Series 6, has said how difficult it's been filming without her. So we do not think that she did do any filming for Series 6, the final one of Peaky Blinders. J.K. Rowling, the Harry Potter link, has also paid tribute, describing it as heartbreaking news, saying she was an extraordinary actress and a wonderful woman who's left us far too soon. And there's also been a tribute from the comedian and actor Matt Lucas, because during lockdown, he worked with Helen McCrory and Damian Lewis to raise almost £1 million for Feed NHS. It was a charity which persuaded restaurants to donate food to feed frontline care workers. Again, an example of the kind of thing that she would do on the side. She had a great quote when asked to sum up what she made for her philosophy about life. Helen McCrory said, "I'm a very positive person. My grandmother taught me that happiness is both a skill and a decision, and you are responsible for the outcome."
Very wise words indeed. Colin, thanks very much. Colin Paterson there, remembering Helen McCrory, who died at the age of 52 yesterday. More from Charlie at Windsor Castle ahead of the Duke of Edinburgh's funeral coming up.
I didn't have a weakness. I was strong in all departments.
In the 80s, snooker was a national obsession.
It was everywhere. People became addicted.
When they come into the room, it's like an aura.
It was just crazy, crazy time, you know. Now we get in headlines, for good or for bad.
The chevier snooker I ain't playing.
Revealing the inside stories of the gods of snooker. Coming soon to BBC Two and iPlayer.
Good morning. Welcome to Breakfast with me, Charlie State, inside the grounds of Windsor Castle, where today the Queen will lead the royal family and the nation in mourning at the funeral of Prince Philip, the Duke of Edinburgh. The service will pay tribute to Prince Philip's unwavering loyalty to the Queen. New pictures show how many aspects of the ceremony were planned by the Duke himself with military decision.
His funeral designed by him.
A cherished moment during 73 years of marriage. Her Majesty shares one of her favourite photos of herself and her husband relaxing in the Scottish Highlands. This is St George's Chapel in Windsor. A small group of family members will walk through the castle grounds this afternoon in procession behind the Duke's coffin. We'll be looking ahead to the service on the programme this morning.
Also on Breakfast, a first Friday night out in months. We'll have a report from Leeds, where many enjoyed the easing of England's lockdown restrictions.
Good morning in sport. The World Snooker Championship gets underway in Sheffield later, and fans will be in attendance at the Crucible, the first indoor sporting event to admit spectators as part of the government's pilot scheme.
Good morning. A quiet weekend of weather ahead. Yes, it's a chilly start once again, but there should be some decent spells of sunshine for most of us throughout the day. All the details coming up shortly.
It's Saturday, the 17th of April. Good morning from Windsor Castle, where the funeral of the Duke of Edinburgh will take place this afternoon, watched by millions of people around the world. It will be a small family affair because, in line with COVID restrictions, only 30 people will be allowed into St George's Chapel. The Queen will sit alone as she says goodbye to her husband of 73 years. Buckingham Palace said the service will focus on Prince Philip's association with the Royal Navy and his love of the sea. On Breakfast this morning, we've been hearing from those who knew the Duke and those who've been involved in planning today's events. Here's our royal correspondent, Nicholas Witchell.
A husband and wife, a photograph from the Queen's private collection, an image from a strong marriage, and a reminder that today there is a wife saying farewell to a beloved partner of 73 years. Inside Windsor Castle, St George's Chapel has been made ready. The Duke of Edinburgh's many decorations have been placed on the altar. Close by, the seat he used to occupy. The enamelled stall plate is still in place, but his insignia as a Knight of the Garter has been removed. It will be in this section of the chapel, known as the choir, where the 30 members of the congregation will be seated around the catafalque bearing the Duke's coffin. The funeral procession will have made its way to the chapel from the castle's quadrangle. Just after 2:40, his coffin will be borne from the state entrance to be placed on the Land Rover hearse the Duke helped to design. At 2:45, the small procession will step off for the 8-minute journey through the castle. Some members of the royal family will walk behind the coffin. The Queen will follow in a limousine. At 2:53, the coffin will arrive at the west steps of St. George's Chapel. It will be borne to the top of the steps, where it will pause. At 3:00, a 1-minute silence will be observed before the coffin enters the chapel for the funeral service, which will be presided over by the Archbishop of Canterbury.
As with all funerals, there's a huge sense of privilege that you're with the family, any family, at this remarkable point in their lives where they're grieving someone they loved profoundly. And then with this funeral, there is also that extra sense of huge privilege, but also pride in his life. The pride is not that I'm there. The pride is here we are celebrating such a wonderful life.
Within the chapel, the order of service will proceed precisely as the Duke had prescribed. He chose the music and the readings.
There's a lot in there that is very him. You know, we've got a Land Rover that's been designed by him. He's taken a personal interest in every aspect of it, but in particular, the selection of which units, which bands, which music, which medals will be there. So it is very much his funeral designed by him.
The service will end with the lowering of his coffin to the royal vault below the chapel. Royal Marine buglers will sound the last post, and then action stations, a reminder of the Duke's years of service in the Royal Navy, a reminder too that he was a royal consort with a difference, distinctive to the end. Nicholas Witchell, BBC News.
So in terms of the timings, a reminder the service itself will begin at 3:00. This afternoon. That will follow the nationwide 1-minute silence. The order of service has been released by Buckingham Palace. We can have a look at that now. And inside there is a message from the Dean of Windsor, who will lead the service, paying tribute to Prince Philip's kindness, humour and humanity. Let's speak to our royal correspondent, Sarah Campbell, who's with me now. Sarah, we are blessed with this beautiful sunshine. Mm-hmm. This morning. Tell us a little bit more about what we know of the service itself.
Well, the service itself, the order of service was released late last night. And I think as with all the details to do with today, which have been made public over the last week, the sense is very much that this was the Duke's plan. He very much had a hand in what television viewers will see today. And I think it's worth right there reiterating again the message to not come to Windsor. All of this will be behind castle walls. So the best place to watch it really is on television. So the order of service, perhaps people might be surprised, but actually this is fairly common for royal funerals. No members of the royal family will give readings, there will be no eulogy, but there is a sense of the Duke's love of the sea, his naval past throughout the music that's been chosen throughout the readings. For example, the hymn Eternal Father Strong to Save, this is going to be sung, it's traditionally associated with seafarers and sort of maritime armed services. As the coffin is lowered into the royal vault at the end, there will be buglers who will play action stations. This is the call on warships to get people to go to man the battle stations. Again, a real nod to the Duke's military past, and of course he saw active service during the Second World War.
Now, one of the things those involved in the military planning, but also the royal household, have said themselves is there, in a way, will be two different tones. There will be the procession with the military accompaniment, and there is a moment when it becomes very much a private family funeral.
Yeah, you're right. So it's kind of in two separate stages that people will see when they watch it. Like you say, the procession. So this is when the coffin will be borne from the state apartments through the grounds of Windsor Castle. There will be detachments from the armed services, particular regiments that he had a close connection with, which will line the procession route. There will be members of the royal family. His children, Prince William, Prince Harry, will walk behind the coffin as it travels through Windsor's grounds. The Queen will follow in the state Bentley, and that will be, if you think of images of a big royal family event with the military, with all of that, you know, the pomp and circumstance, if you like, there will be the King's troop, Royal Horse Artillery will be firing guns, there will be a bell tolling. But when it comes to the chapel itself, after that minute's silence, rather than 800 mourners,